Hello, today we shall see the twist wheel, the drafting system gearing, and the bobbin rail movement. Before we go further with these topics, let us just revise a little bit with the conventional gearing diagram. In the last lecture, we have seen how the spindle as well as the bobbin is driven. We know that the spindle gets a fixed speed, whereas the bobbin gets a variable speed, and the bobbin speed needs to reduce as the bobbin is being built. So the gearing actually begins with this motor driving the motor pulley, and the motor pulley driving this particular set of pulleys here, which is mounted on the machine shaft. And the machine shaft is driven. Via the machine shaft, the speed is transferred through a simple set of gears to the spindle and basically the flyer here. And the bobbin is driven by the same machine shaft end wheel, which is shown as a twist wheel over here. And this twist wheel further goes on to drive the top conundrum and the bottom conundrum. And whatever variable speed this conundrum set has to offer, it will be given further or transmitted to the one of the gears or the casing of the differential box. And the differential box will add up these speeds, that is the fixed speed that comes from the machine shaft, along with the speed that comes from the conundrums, and together that excess speed will be transferred to the bobbin via the set of gearing that is shown here. So we had seen this much in detail as to how these speeds are transferred. So with this background, we shall go further and see how this twist wheel is affecting the twist in the roving. And if I need to change the twist in the roving, what is the factor that needs to be changed? It is twist wheel is basically a change wheel. Now we all know that twist inserted is twist per inch, and that is equal to flyer speed in RPM divided by the front roller delivery in inches per minute. From the above equation, we know that for changing the twist in the roving, one has to change either the flyer speed or the front roller speed. So let us see which factor amongst these two, when changed, will give me better results, or which is a better option to choose. Change in only the flyer speed will result in the changes in the roving tension and thereby affect breakage rates. So if we were to choose the option of changing the flyer speed, then it will result in changes in roving tension and also affect breakage rates. So this may not be a good idea to choose flyer speed change as a change for twist changes. So therefore, the second option, that is the front roller speed, has to be changed and is a preferred way of doing it. If the front roller speed, that is the delivery rate, is changed, in that case, we also need to remember that we need to change the speed of the bobbin also, because whatever is delivered by the front roller has to be wound by the bobbin. So if we make any changes because of change in twist in the front roller speed, then we have to see to it that there is a corresponding change in the bobbin speed, which is useful for winding the change in the delivery of this particular roving. So from the above discussion, it is clear that the twist wheel must be able to change the delivery of the front roller and also the bobbin speed, but without any changes in the flyer speed. Also, we must note that there is no change in the draft values, and this particular point will be discussed later in this lecture. Coming back to this gearing, as we said, that this twist wheel must be in a position to change the delivery of the front roller so that we are able to change the TPI. And this is how it is done. This end wheel, which is also known as twist wheel, will drive one wheel, V, that is shown over here, which is responsible for driving the shaft, and this W wheel will drive the front roller over here. So if we make any changes in this particular wheel, it will directly affect the speed of the front roller, and subsequently there will be a change in the TPI. We also said that if at all we change the delivery rate of the front roller, we have to change the bobbin speed, because winding will get affected, and that is also achieved via this particular twist wheel. The moment we change the twist wheel, automatically there will be a change in the top conundrum speed, And further on, there's a change in the bottom chondrum, which is further transmitted to the differential box and which further goes to the bobbin. And one will see a corresponding change in the bobbin speed as well. So change of twist wheel for changing TPI will have a change in the delivery speed as well as the bobbin speed that is required for winding. But one must remember that there is no change in the flyer speed. So this flyer, which is driven via this set of gears, since twist wheel is not affecting any of the speeds in this gear train, the flyer speed or the spindle speed does not change. Also, another thing that is to be noted here is that the draft values will also not change, because this wheel, when changed, twist wheel, it will only affect the front roller speed, but further the front roller drives the back roller as well as the middle roller, and that is why if at all there is any change in the front roller speed, there will be a corresponding change in the back as well as the middle roller speed. And that is, if the front roller speed increases, the back or the and also the middle roller will also increase in speed. And because of this corresponding or proportional increase in both the speeds, there is the ratio, which is the draft value between the rollers, will not change. So this particular wheel, we must remember, only affects the front roller delivery and the bobbin speed. So with this, we go to the next discussion on the effect of twist wheel on draft. So in this particular gearing diagram, there's a similar effect. Similarly, in the gearing diagram shown, the wheels D, G or H, that is shown here, D, G or H, can change the twist levels by changing the front roller. Again, the concept or the background is the same. Twist is always changed by a change in the front roller speed and not by a change in the spindle speed. And these particular wheels are also responsible for a change in the bobbin speed without any change in the flyer speed, just like before. Since we can see that D, G or H, any change in any one of these wheels will affect the front roller speed over here, and at the same time affect the speed of the top chondrum, bottom chondrum and the entire set of gears through the differential box, which drives the bobbin. So there is a change in the, although there is a change in the front roller delivery speed as well as the bobbin speed, one will find that there is no change in the flyer speed, which is driven directly via this particular machine shaft through a set of gears. But D, out of these three gears, D, G and H, D is the most accessible one, which is on the outer side of the machine framing, and hence it is more likely to be used as a twist wheel. Also, there is no change in the draft values, just like before, since the other drafting rollers are driven by the front roller, and there is therefore a proportionate change in the speed of the other rollers when the front roller speed is changed. So we can see the train of gears. Once the front roller is driven, the middle and the back roller also are driven through a set of gears, and any change in the front roller speed will also change both these speeds, and therefore the ratios of the surface speeds will not change, and therefore the drafts will also not change. Now let us discuss the draft change pinion. Once the speed reaches the front roller, we have already seen that it will further drive the back roller through a set of gears. We can just trace it, 20 drives 84, which on the same shaft we find this DCP, that is draft change pinion, which is shown in red, which drives 110 teeth gear or slash maybe 83. On the same shaft, this is the back roller shaft, back roller is driven, and on the same shaft we find a wheel of 52 teeth, which drives 32 teeth wheel, and then on the same shaft we find this blue colored wheel, which is termed as BDCP. We'll see what this is, and this BDCP drives the middle roller. And one more thing to see is that all the rollers here are assumed to be of the same diameter. So with this background, let us see how this draft change pinion is calculated and what is the importance of this particular wheel. The front roller drives the middle and the back roller through the wheels shown in the diagram. So we have already seen the seen how the speeds are passed on. The red wheel is the DCP and will change the speed of the middle roller as well as the back roller in the same proportion. Once the back roller is speed is changed because of any change in the DCP here, automatically even the middle roller will change because back roller is driving the middle roller. So therefore, it shall not change the draft between the middle and the back roller, because this is also known as a brake draft. The draft between middle and back roller is known as a brake draft. And there is no change in this ratio, that is the ratio between the middle and the back roller surface speeds, because both will change simultaneously. If there is any change in the back roller, the middle roller speed also changes in the same direction and same proportion. So brake draft will not change. That is, if the back roller speed increases, it shall also increase the speed of the middle roller, and therefore the brake draft remains constant. So the DCP shall only change the draft between the front and the middle roller, that is the main draft. So if there is any change in the DCP, then in that case both these roller speeds will change, and because of that, front roller speed, say if it is X, then the middle roller speed will change, and there is a change in the draft between only the middle roller and the front roller, which is the main draft. So DCP will not affect the brake draft, but will definitely affect the main draft that is applied between front and middle roller. So coming to the brake draft change pinion, which is shown in blue over here, the blue wheel is the BDCP and it drives the middle roller only. So when you trace the gearing train of wheels that drives the middle roller, we see that BDCP is the wheel which comes in between the back roller and the middle roller when the speed is transmitted from back to middle. So any change in the BDCP will change the draft, because only the middle roller speed will change in this case, and the ratio between middle and back will change automatically, which is nothing but the brake draft. Brake draft applied between the middle roller and the back roller. The quality of the roving is affected by the brake draft, and therefore it is not normally changed very frequently. So there is no frequent change in the this particular wheel, because the brake draft affects the quality of the roving very drastically, and therefore this is not frequently changed. So with this, let us see how to calculate the draft constant. We know that draft constant is draft when CP or DCP is 1. So draft is calculated by using this formula: surface speed of front roller upon surface speed of back roller, which is, we can say it is pi DF, that is diameter of the front roller, into NF, that is RPM of the front roller, divided by pi into diameter of the back roller multiplied by speed of the back roller. So if the diameters are same as shown, that is DF is equal to DB, so we can directly cancel all these four factors over here, which are constant and same. So draft is equal to speed of the front roller, that is RPM, divided by speed of the back roller in RPM. So this can be replaced as NF divided by NF into, because front roller drives the back roller. So let us trace the gears. NF, that is speed of the front roller, multiplied by this 20 divided by 84 multiplied by DCP divided by 110. So this is how we get the speed of the back roller, which is substituted here in the denominator. So again, NF gets cancelled, and if we were to reverse this, we get the answer as 462, taking DCP as 1, since our definition itself said draft constant is draft when DCP is 1. So we put a value of DCP as 1 here and calculate this particular figure here, we get an answer of 462. So in a similar way, we can calculate the brake draft. So brake draft is equal to surface speed of middle roller divided by surface speed of back roller, which is nothing but pi into DM into NB. This will be middle roller NM divided by pi into DB into NB. So please correct this mistake, it is NM, speed of the middle roller. So if the diameters are same as shown, dm is equal to db. So again, all these things will get cancelled. So draft is nothing but break draft is nothing but speed of the middle roller divided by speed of the back roller, which we can substitute in this manner. Speed of the middle roller, this middle roller gets its speed from the back roller, so we can trace the gears back from the back roller. So back roller speed into 52 divided by 32 multiply by BDCP divided by 41, we get the speed of the middle roller, which is there in the numerator, divided by NB, which is the speed of the back roller. So if we were to cancel NB over here, and so we can get this particular formula in this manner. Break draft is equal to, this will get converted into a constant, which is 0.0396 into BDCP. So we can calculate break draft as well as draft constant, and we can do the other draft calculations by using these formulas. So now we come to another important topic, that is the bobbin rail movement. And in case of bobbin rail, we must consider the following two things or two cases. The first one is the reversal of the bobbin rail, and the second is the bobbin rail traverse speed. So we shall discuss both these points in detail. Reversal of the bobbin rail. We know that to make the roving bobbin, the bobbin rail has to reverse every time it reaches the end of the lift for each layer as a bobbin is being built up. So we see this gearing diagram, and we can trace how the bobbin rail is actually driven, and we can trace it in this manner. Once the top conundrum receives its speed from this machine shaft, it drives the bottom roller, bottom conundrum over here, which further through this set of gears will drive this particular bevel gears here, which is there on this vertical shaft. And we can see this gear D over here, which is in touch with the plate bevels, and this shaft over here then will continue further, and via the set of wheels it will drive this particular pinion and the rack. So which is this rack is then connected actually to the bobbin rail. So whatever speed is being transmitted, this particular pinion will help it to move the rack in a certain direction, and the bobbin rail will get its motion. So here this is a slightly exploded view of it. This is the bottom conundrum from which F, then R, and then these particular bevels, D, and then U over here, then this particular shaft, and then these are A, B, C, D wheels, and this is E, and this rack is driven. So the reversal of the bobbin rail may take place due to the alternate engagement of the plate bevels with the bevel D that receives its speed from the bottom conundrum, which we have just seen. This bevel D now rotates in the same direction throughout the build of the bobbin. So whatever speed it gets, suppose it is getting a speed in the, say, clockwise direction, so this particular vertical shaft will always be rotating in the same direction. There is no change in the direction for this particular shaft. But when this D comes in touch with one of these plate bevels, which at in the current situation is shown as U, in this as shown here, in that case this U shall receive the speed in one particular direction, which is then transmitted to the rack and pinion, and let us say that the bobbin rail is moving upwards. After some time, this U is disengaged, and this particular second plate bevel, which is now currently not engaged, will get engaged with this particular D, and this will help in rotating this particular shaft now in the opposite direction. If it earlier it was clockwise, now it will rotate in anti-clockwise direction, and the same direction is passed on to this particular rack, which will now bring the bobbin rail downwards. So this alternate engagement of the plate bevel reverses the direction of rotation of the shaft. That this is the shaft we are talking about, that further drives the bobbin rail. The alternate engagement of the plate bevels is controlled by the building mechanism. Now this task of bringing the plate bevels alternately after the end of the lift into position and let it be driven by the wheel D, this particular task is the task of the building mechanism, which is shown here. this building mechanism with its tail, which is connected to this particular shaft, which can even move laterally or in a horizontal manner. This particular shaft is moved at the end of the lift. It will, this once this U bevel will come into position, and after some time this other plate bevel is brought into position, so that alternately this particular pinion gets its upward and downward clockwise and anti-clockwise motion, which is transmitted to this particular rack, which goes up and down, which is the motion that is required for the bobbin ring. So this was one kind of arrangement. We can also have a much simpler looking arrangement, but the concept is the same. A similar reversal can be achieved by the shifting rod that rotates in the same direction but can shift horizontally as shown in a diagram. Now we are talking about this particular rod on which the plate bevels are fixed, and this rod has got speed in the same direction, and but it can be laterally moved to the right and left, and this is this movement is done, the left and right movement is done with the help of an electrically operated valve that pressurizes the left and the right chamber of the double acting cylinder. So this is a double acting cylinder 9 over here, which will bring alternately these plate bevels into position. Engagement of bevels 1 and 2 with 3 alternately at the end of the lift causes the vertical shaft 4. Now the plate bevels are responsible for driving this vertical shaft in the clockwise and the anti-clockwise direction, and the reversed speed is then transmitted to the sprocket wheel, which is marked 7 over here, resulting in the chain connected to it to move up and down. This chain, once if this sprocket wheel rotates clockwise and anti-clockwise, this chain will automatically be moving up and down, and the other end of this chain is attached or connected to the bobbin rail, which gets its up and down motion. So this is another arrangement which one can have, either the earlier one or this one, for reversal of the bobbin rail. So with this, let us come to the second point which was mentioned, that is the traverse speed of the bobbin rail. For that, we need to understand the laying of the coils on the roving bobbin. So let us first understand this. The coils are laid on the full length of the bobbin, leaving little portions on both the ends for easy handling. So let us imagine that the first layer is being filled up, and as it is being laid on both the sides of the edges of the bobbin, some amount of area is left blank or unwound, and those portions are basically left without any roving winding, so that it is easy for further handling. The coils that are laid on the surface of the bobbin in each of its layers must be laid very close to, as close as possible to each other. There should not be any gap, and there should be an optimum distance between each adjacent coils. So the coils should here should not be on each other also, and neither it should be too much further away from each other. It should be touching each other as neatly as possible, and the reason for that is, if the distance between any two coils is high, then it leads to an underutilization of the bobbin capacity. That means we are not using the bobbin to its full capacity, and where more roving could have been wound on that single bobbin, we will have to do with the lower amount of roving on the package, which is not really acceptable. So the coil should be closely laid beside each other. And on the other hand, if the coils were to ride over each other, that means if the coils were so close that one would be riding on the other, then it results in the damage to the wound roving, and maybe even slough offs during unwinding. So the coils may be laid on the bobbin by keeping, now there are two methods to lay this coil. One is by keeping the bobbin fixed vertically, there is no vertical movement to the bobbin, and moving the laying point, that is the flyer, we move up and down so that we are able to lay the roving. Or the second option to available is that we make the movement of the up and down movement of the bobbin vertically and keep the flyer fixed and not give any vertical movement to it. So which one is preferable? Let us see. And why we are giving the up and down motion to the bobbin rail rather than to the flyer. So this is a diagram which will explain that. We can see the roving that is coming from the front roller is being passed onto the top of the flyer of one of the rows, that is a back row of the spindles. So the second option is chosen because if in case we were to choose the first option where we give vertical movement to the flyer for the laying of the coils, in that case the unsupported length, that is this length from the roller nip to the flyer top, and also the angle of approach. This is the angle of approach, the angle that the roving makes with the vertical, that is the spindle axis, is the angle of approach. And this angle of approach will always, as well as an unsupported length, they will keep changing. If this flyer position were to be somewhere here, then both the angle of approach as well as the unsupported length will change. Same happens if this flyer was placed more down somewhere over here, the angle of approach coming will change. So changes in any of this will affect the roving quality again, which again shall be discussed in detail later on. So this option, the first option of giving an up and down motion to the flyer is not acceptable. So we go with the second option where the bobbin is given up and down vertical motion. So we have justified the earlier discussion where the bobbin rail is getting an up and down motion via the gearing diagrams that we have just seen. So with this background, we are now sure that the bobbin has to get up and down motion. So the speed transmission to the bobbin rail, the vertical speed may be transmitted to the bobbin rail by the rack and pinion, which we have seen, that is via this, or by the with the help of the lever, which is shown here. This we had seen, this sprocket and the chain, and which was then connected to the bobbin rail, and the bobbin rail would move up and down. In case of the rack and pinion, we have this train of wheels here, top conundrum, which is not seen over here, to bottom conundrum, and then F, R, S, T, D, U, and then A, B, C, D, and E, which finally drives the rack. So we can see this pinion and rack and pinion motion, which is then attached to the bobbin rail, which helps in giving the up and down motion to the bobbin rail, and the bobbin will be moving up and down. Flyer will not have any vertical movement to it. So with this, let us see bobbin rail traverse speed, whether it is the same or it needs to be changed, or how or why do we need to change it. We know that the roving delivered by the front roller is constant and has to be wound on the bobbin that increases in diameter with each layer that is laid on it. So the front roller delivery is constant, and this has to be wound on the bobbin, which is constantly increasing in its diameter. This we have already seen earlier in detail, but now let us go a little bit more into it. Let d, small d r, be the diameter of the roving, and capital DB be the diameter of the bobbin. So this is these are the coils that are laid one after the other to make this particular layer. So number of layers that can be wound per minute, that is L. If F is the front roller surface speed and DB is a bobbin diameter at any given instance, then the number of coils that is being laid would be equal to the front roller delivery. Suppose this is surface speed is in, say, inches per minute, and then we have this divided by pi into dB, which is the circumference of this particular. So suppose it is laying the first layer on the bobbin, then in that case it would be pi into diameter of the bobbin at that instance. So the number of coils that would be made by this delivery would be F divided by pi into dB. So therefore, the distance that the bobbin rail has to move per minute, let us say it is TBR, vertically to wind the number of coils is number of coils into DR, where DR is the roving diameter. So if the number of coils are, say, 10 that needs to be wound for F amount of delivery by the front roller, in that case, the TBR would be F upon pi into dB into dr, which is nothing but N into dr. So the number of coils into roving diameter would be the distance that this particular traverse needs to go. So we can just substitute N over here by F upon pi into dB and multiply by dr would give me the traverse for the bobbin rail. Now, since F and pi are constant, and once any particular roving is being wound on any roving frame, in that case even diameter of the roving is also constant. So since these three factors are constant, the traverse speed of the bobbin rail is inversely proportional to the bobbin diameter. And F, dr and pi are all constant for the given DOF. That means one particular, when the roving frame is running, it will be constant for that particular DOF. So from this entire discussion here, it may be concluded that the traverse speed of the bobbin rail must be reduced as the diameter of the bobbin increases. So as the diameter of the bobbin increases, the traverse speed of the bobbin rail must reduce as the layers are being built. So how this is done? Drive to the bobbin rail. Now, fortunately for us, this is automatically happening because the drive to the bobbin rail is transmitted through the cone drums, which we have seen the train of gears just now. And in both cases of the drive, that is whether it is rack or pinion or by lever in this case, the speed will always be coming from the bottom cone drum, and it is a variable speed. And this variable speed is was initially used to drive the bobbin, and we have seen in the earlier lecture it is used to drive the bobbin and give a reduced speed to the bobbin as the layers are being built. And the same speed is now also passed on to the rack and pinion. So automatically, as the bobbin is being built layer by layer, the speeds are reduced, and it is the same reduced speed is transferred to the bobbin rail as well. So one need not do anything much in this gearing. Automatically this is happening because the gear train is kept in such a way that with the increase in diameter of the bobbin, automatically the traverse speed of the bobbin rail will also keep on reducing. And this is done, we know, by the shifting of the belt from left to right, as seen earlier in the case of transferring reduced speed to the bobbin. So therefore, in short, the concluding statement of this particular discussion is that therefore the speed of the bobbin rail reduces after each layer that is laid on the bobbin as the bobbin builds up. So with this, we come to the end of this particular lecture. Thank you.